Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We are continuing on with the chapter, and we are discussing the narration when Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anh saw a man shiver when a hadith pertaining to the attributes of Allah was mentioned, and he shook because he was denying these attributes. So Abdullah ibn Abbas mentioned the verses which are muhkamat. These are those ayat in the Quran which are clear in their meaning, as opposed to the mutashabihat, which are unclear in their meaning. The word muhkam can also have another meaning. It comes from ihkam, which is to do something perfectly, without any deficiency. So when it comes to the ayat of Allah Jalla wa'ala in the Qur'an, then all of them are muhkam, in that they are perfect in their eloquence, in their style, in their truthfulness, so you will not find any lies in the ayat of the Qur'an. Likewise with the rulings that they give, they are completely just. So from this angle, all of the ayat in the Qur'an are muhkam. If you take muhkam to mean something which is done perfectly, as Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 115, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدَلًا. And the words of your Lord have been completed or perfected, both in terms of their truth and justice. So truth in terms of the news items which the Qur'an gives, and justice in terms of the laws which Allah gives. They are all the most just laws. So from this angle, all of the ayat are muhkam. Also he says in Surah Yunus, تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ الْحَكِيمِ. These are the ayat of the kitab, which is al-hakim, meaning perfected or done well in terms of its linguistic style, eloquence, truthfulness and justice. Likewise, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, kitabun uhkimat ayatuhu, a book whose ayat are made muhkam. The word al-mutashabih can also have another meaning if it is just mentioned alone, and it comes from ash-shibah, which means to resemble. So the ayat in the Quran, they resemble each other in terms of their perfection, in terms of their literary eloquence, in terms of their truth, and in terms of their justice, and that you will not find contradictions in the ayat of Allah. As he says in Surah Az-Zumar, Allahu nazzala ahsan al-hadithi kitaban mutashabihan mathaniya. Allah sent down the best of speech, a book whose ayat are resembling and often repeated. So the ayat of Allah Jalla wa'ala resemble each other in terms of their literary eloquence and in terms of their truth and justice. But if muhkam and mutashabih are mentioned together to describe the Qur'an, then muhkam are those ayat in which the meanings are entirely clear and there are no doubts about what the meaning is. And then as for the mutashabih, then the meanings are unclear. But this mutashabih can be further divided into two types, and we are talking about the mutashabih when the meaning is unclear. First of all, we have the al-mutashabih al-nisbi, the relative mutashabih. This is those ayat which are unclear to some people but not to others. So some people know the meaning and others don't, depending on your level of knowledge and understanding. Then we have the al-mutashabih al-mutlaq. Nobody knows the meaning of this except Allah. So when we find in Surah Al Imran the critical ayah telling us that this Quran contains ayat which are muhkam and ayat which are mutashabih, هُوَ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ مِنْهُ آيَاتٌ مُحْكَمَاتٌ هُنَّ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ وَأُخَرُ مُتَشَابِهَاتٌ. He is the one who has sent down the Quran to you. From it there are those ayat which are muhkamat. They are the foundations of the book. So everything must be referred to these muhkamat. And others are mutashabihat, or unclear in their meaning. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْهُ بِتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ وَبِتِغَاءَ تَأْوِيلِهِ. So as for those people in whose hearts there is a disease, they follow these mutashabihat, seeking fitna, meaning to put people in doubt using these unclear ayat, or to propagate their false beliefs, and they seek to interpret these mutashabihat. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ يَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِهِ كُلٌّ مِّنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّنَا وَمَا يَذَّكَّرُ إِلَّا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And no one knows their interpretations, meaning the interpretation of the mutashabihat, except Allah and those who are firmly grounded in knowledge. They say, we believe in it, all of it is from our Lord, and no one would receive admonition except the people of sound understanding. Now, there is a difference of opinion amongst the early mufassireen. Where do you make a waqf or a stop in this ayah? Do you say, وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, and nobody knows their interpretation except Allah, and then you stop, take a breath, and then you go on reciting, وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ يَقُولُونَ, and those who are firmly grounded in knowledge, they say. So upon this, only Allah Jalla wa'ala knows the interpretation of these mutashabihat. because you stopped at Allah and you did not continue. As for if you continue, which is the other opinion, so it will be وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ يَقُولُونَ. And nobody knows their interpretation except Allah and those who are firmly grounded in knowledge, they say, up until the end of the ayah. So if you make the wasl, which is the continuation, then this is referring to the al-mutashabih and nisbi. So these are those mutashabihat which some people of knowledge know and others don't. So Allah Jalla wa Ala knows them, and those who are firmly grounded in knowledge also know the interpretation. So it depends which mutashabih you are looking at. If you are taking the al-mutashabih al-mutlaq, then you stop at the word Allah. If you intend the al-mutashabih al-nisbi, then you will continue on. And remember, al-mutashabih al-mutlaq is that mutashabih which only Allah Jalla wa Ala knows the interpretation of. By way of an example, in the Quran, Allah Jalla wa Ala informs us about his characteristics. We know what these words mean, but how these characteristics manifest, we don't know. And nobody knows except Allah. So therefore, this is a mutashabih al-mutlaq, an absolute mutashabih, which nobody knows the interpretation of except Allah. So the names and attributes of Allah, the reality of how these attributes manifest, only Allah Jalla wa Ala knows. And anybody claiming to know this is obviously a liar. Similarly, Allah Jalla wa Ala informs us about Jannah and Jahannam, and things which will happen in the future, like the Ya'juj and Ma'juj coming down, and the Dabbatul Ard from the signs of Al-Qiyamah. The realities of these, how they will manifest and look like, nobody knows except Allah. We know what the words mean, and we believe it and accept it. But as for the kayfiyah, the reality of how it will manifest, only Allah knows. So again, this is an example of al-mutashabih al-mutlaq. As for Jannah, Allah Jalla wa Ala describes this in Surah As-Sajda when he says, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. So no soul knows what has been kept hidden for them from the delights of the eye because of what they used to do. So although we are informed about Jannah, but still we don't actually know it, or we cannot comprehend the reality of Jannah. Likewise with Jahannam. We can try to imagine, but we will not be able to, as Abdullah ibn Abbas said in his explanation, that the only thing which is same between Jannah and this world is the name. So for example, in Jannah you know you will have fruits to eat, but in this world you also have fruits. But the only thing which is same is the actual name itself, fruits. As for the reality of how these fruits will look like, then we don't know. Likewise, there will be rivers of water, milk, honey and wine. But in this world, we also have these drinks. But the name is the only thing which is the same, not the reality of it. So the details of Jannah and Jahannam, though we understand the words, the reality of it is al-mutashabih al-mutlaq. As for the second mutashabih, which is al-mutashabih al-nisbi, then these are the ayat which may seem unclear to many people. However, to those who are firmly rooted in knowledge, they are clear and can be explained. And it has been narrated that Abdullah ibn Abbas said, I am from those who are firmly rooted in knowledge, who knows the interpretations of the ayah. He did not say this to praise himself, because a person should not praise himself. But rather he said this to let the people know that he knows the interpretations of the ayat of the Qur'an. So if they want to know what they are, then let them come to him and study. And as for the meanings of the words of the Qur'an, then it is not possible for there to be any word in the Qur'an, the meaning of which is unknown to absolutely everyone. It may be unknown to some people, but there will always be scholars, those who are firmly rooted in knowledge, who will know the meaning. And we do not say like how the Mufawwidah say, that when it comes to the attributes of Allah, then we do not know the meanings of these words. And we leave the meaning to Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is a big mistake. If we have scholars or mufassirun who are giving different interpretations of the ayah, then if their interpretations are a contradiction, then the truth must lie with one of them and not with the other. And everybody makes mistakes. Sometimes you can have different interpretations of the ayah, but they are not contradictory. So if there is no way of deciding which is the weightier opinion, then there is no problem in accepting both opinions. We know that Allah Jalla wa Ala says, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتْدَبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. A blessed book which we have sent down, that they may ponder over its ayat, and that the men of understanding may remember. And we know it is not possible to ponder over the ayat if we don't know the meaning. So there cannot be a case in the Qur'an in which we don't know the meaning of the words. And from the words are the words of the attributes of Allah. So we have to know the meanings of these words, otherwise we will not be able to ponder over them. And we cannot say that this ayah just refers to the muhkamat and not the mutashabihat. Rather, it refers to the whole of the Qur'an, because he says, لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ, that they may ponder over its ayat. It's general, it's not making any exception. So it includes every ayah, without exception. So we know the meanings of every single ayah. Somebody might say, but what about the al-huruf al-muqatta'a, the individual letters which you find at the beginning of some of these surah in the Qur'an? For example, alif lam mim, or ha mim, or kaf ha ya ayn sad, and these types of letters. Somebody may ask, what are the meanings of these letters? These are mutashabihat. The answer is, these are letters and they are not words. And letters don't have meanings in and of themselves. Words do when they are put in correct context. And so they are not supposed to have a meaning. So if they don't have a meaning in and of themselves, then what is the point in them being in the Qur'an? There is a point, and it is to show the reader that these letters are from the Arabic letters. Hence this Qur'an is an Arabic Qur'an, using your own letters, using your own words, your own language. Yet still, you will not be able to produce anything similar to it. Because if the Qur'an was revealed in some alien language which nobody knew about, then people could have an excuse. Yes, we cannot produce the like of the Qur'an because it's revealed in some alien language. So they would say, you cannot blame us for not producing the like thereof. But because it is revealed in your own language, O Arab, and you are still not able to produce anything similar to it, so it shows that this Qur'an is not from man. It must be from an external superior source. So therefore, to summarize, we can say that the whole Qur'an is mutashabih from one angle, if we take mutashabih to mean resembling each other, and the whole Qur'an is also muhkam, if we take muhkam to mean something which is done well. And also, the whole Qur'an is muhkam in terms of its meaning as well, because anything which is unclear from the Qur'an, then it is to be referred to those ayat which are clear. So if you look at it in the proper context, then the whole Qur'an actually is muhkam, in that you know the meanings of the ayat of the Qur'an. So if you do not know the meaning of a certain ayah, it does not mean that nobody knows the meaning. And this is true except for the letters at the beginning of certain surahs. And as stated before, these letters are not meant to have a meaning, but they are there to challenge the Arab. And also, just take a note here, that there are many people, particularly the kuffar and orientalists, who try to find contradictions in the Qur'an. And they will try their best to take two ayat of the Qur'an and to show people that they are in contradiction. But the only thing they are actually showing is that they don't understand these ayat properly. Because if they understood it properly, then there would be no contradiction. So that's the first thing they are showing. The second thing they are showing is that in their hearts there is a disease. Because Allah Jalla wa Ala says, as we quoted in the ayah from Surah Ali Imran, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْهُ بِتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ وَبِتِغَاءَ تَأْوِيلِهِ. Then as for those in whose hearts there is a deviancy, a zayg, then they follow the mutashabihat, the unclear ayat, in order to create fitna. And from the fitna is that they try to portray the Qur'an as contradicting itself or being deficient in any way. And they try to interpret these ayat in ways that are in accordance with their own desires, so they can promote their false arguments and beliefs. So just be aware of these types of people, and know that there is a zayg in their heart, a deviancy. Then the Shaykh rahimahullah goes on to state that when the tribe of Quraysh heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioning Ar-Rahman, which is one of the names of Allah, they denied this in that they did not recognize who is Ar-Rahman. And Allah jalla wa ala revealed the ayah in Surah Ar-Ra'd, which we quoted, وَهُمْ يَكْفَرُونَ بِالرَّحْمَنِ, and they disbelieve in Ar-Rahman. And this is pertaining to the story of the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah, which we mentioned, and Suhail ibn Amr, the representative of the Quraysh, he refused to have Ar-Rahman written down in the treaty when the Prophet ﷺ told them to write down Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So he said, we do not know who this Ar-Rahman is, but rather they said, write down Bismik Allahumma. And so Allah Jalla wa Ala revealed this ayah, وَهُمْ يَكْفُرُونَ بِالرَّحْمَنِ, they disbelieve in Ar-Rahman, meaning to say they disbelieve in this name. They do not disbelieve in Allah. We know they believed in Allah, they had Tawheed Ar-Rububiyyah. And as stated before, in this ayah there is evidence that anyone denying any name of Allah is a kafir. And we gave the category of denial at the beginning of this chapter. Issues in this chapter, issue number 1, the denial of any name of Allah or attribute, takes you out of the fold of Al-Islam, and we gave the categories of this before. Issue number 2, the tafsir of the ayah of Surah Ar-Ra'd, and we spoke about this. Issue number 3, avoid speaking in a manner which the listener cannot understand properly or is above his head. And this is taken from the statement of Ali radiallahu anhu. Issue number 4, the mention of the reason which leads somebody to deny Allah and His Messenger even unintentionally. Again, this is taken from the statement of Ali radiallahu anhu. Do you want that Allah and His Messenger be denied? And this is if you speak to a people on a level that is above their understanding. For example, if you tell them that on Yawm al-Qiyamah the earth would be like one bread, then they might deny this because they're not used to something like this. Or if you tell them that the as-sirat on Yawm al-Qiyamah will be sharper than a sword and thinner than a strand of hair. Again, this is something beyond their imagination and they may not be able to comprehend it properly. So they might say, no, this is not possible, and hence be belying what the Prophet ﷺ has said. So the issue is to explain to them step by step, just like you explain to a child. Step number 1, then step number 2, and so on, to develop his understanding gradually. Issue number 5, the warning of Abdullah ibn Abbas that whoever denies the attributes of Allah will be ruined. And this is taken from his statement. He said that some people are destroyed when it comes to the mutashabihat. And the point is that the names and attributes of Allah Jalla wa Ala are mutashabihat from one angle, in that nobody knows their reality and how they manifest. As for the meanings of the words, then we have said before, they are well known. End of chapter, question number 1. This chapter is about denying the names and attributes of Allah Jalla wa Ala. We divided up this denial into 2 categories, and the second category has 2 subcategories. So explain all of these categories. Question number 2. When it comes to the names of Allah, we discussed 5 key issues. Recall these 5 key issues in as much detail as you can. Question number 3. We discussed 3 key issues when it comes to the attributes of Allah. Recall them in as much detail as you can. Question number 4. What has the statement of Ali ibn Abi Talib got to do with denying the names and attributes of Allah? Give the attributes of descent to the lowest heaven to illustrate your answer. Question number 5. The Qur'an contains muhkamat and mutashabihat. Each of these words has 2 definitions. Give these 2 definitions. Question number 6. Explain the difference between al-mutashabih al-mutlaq and al-mutashabih al-nisbi, and give some examples of al-mutashabih al-mutlaq. We'll now move over to the next chapter, number 41, which is about recognizing the grace of Allah but yet denying it. The author, rahimahullah, uses the ayah as the title, and this ayah in Surah An-Nahl, number 83, يَعْرِفُونَ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُنْكِرُونَهَا وَأَكْثَرُهُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. They recognize or understand the ni'mah of Allah, or the grace of Allah, or the bounty, yet they deny it. Meaning they say, this grace has come from other than Allah. So they don't give Allah the credit. And most of them are kafirun. The ni'mah of Allah Jalla wa Ala cannot be counted and enumerated, as he says in Surah Ibrahim, ayah 34, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. And if you were to count the ni'mah of Allah, you would not be able to enumerate it. And when he says that they deny this ni'mah, they don't deny its existence. Of course, it exists and it cannot be denied. But they don't relate it to Allah Jalla wa Ala. So they say, it came from other than Allah. He says most of them are kafirun. Actually, all of them are kafirun, because he's talking about the kuffar, but when he says most of them are kafirun, he's saying that most of them recognize the ni'mah of Allah, and despite this, they disbelieve in Allah Jalla wa Ala. That's because some of them disbelieve, but they don't even recognize the ni'mah of Allah in the first place. They are ignorant of these affairs, and they don't understand that this is a ni'mah from Allah. So he's telling us that most of them disbelieve even after recognizing the grace of Allah. And so from them there are some who disbelieve without recognizing the grace of Allah. When he uses the word al-kafirun, either we could take this to mean them disbelieving in Allah Jalla wa Ala, hence they are kafirun, or we could take kafirun to mean ungrateful. So they recognize that this is a ni'mah, but they do not give Allah Jalla wa Ala the credit for it, and they don't thank Allah for it. So this is being ungrateful. And this is what a kafir is. He's somebody who is ungrateful. So the question is, what has this ayah got to do with Kitab al-Tawheed? Anyone who gives credit to anyone other than Allah for the rizq which Allah has provided, then he has joined partners with Allah in the ar-rububiyyah. Because we know that from ar-rububiyyah is that Allah Jalla wa Ala provides for his creation, and he is unique in doing so. and so therefore he is the one only who deserves the credit. So if you give credit to someone else, then you made them as a partner with Allah. The other way we can look at it is that if you are given the grace of Allah and you don't worship Allah, and this is the way you thank Him by worshipping Him, then this contradicts your tawheed, because what is wajib upon the slave is to thank Allah. So in this way you have a defective tawheed al-uluhiyah, whereas from the first perspective you had a defective tawheed al-rububiyah. So we can say in summation that not giving credit to Allah for His ni'mah and not thanking Him has a damaging effect on your tawheed al-rububiyah and your tawheed al-uluhiyah. Then the author rahimahullah gives a quote from Mujahid, and he is from the Mufassirin of the Tabi'in and a famous student of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He went through the Qur'an with Ibn Abbas and he stopped at every ayah and asked him about the tafsir. And Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah, one of the famous scholars, said, if a tafsir comes to you from Mujahid, then this is sufficient for you. However, we do not say that Mujahid or any other scholar of tafsir is perfect and never makes mistakes. However, a tafsir from Mujahid certainly has a high status. And so Mujahid said about this ayah, this is the statement of a man, this wealth is mine, I inherited it from my fathers. So we find that this person is not giving Allah Jalla wa'ala the credit, but rather he's giving his fathers the credit from whom he inherited this wealth. So a statement like this is wrong if you are giving complete credit to your fathers from whom you inherited, and you forget about Allah Jalla wa'ala. As for if his intention in saying this was just to give a news item so that the person who's asking can know where this wealth came from, so he did not buy this wealth, but rather it was inherited. So just giving this news item, there's nothing wrong with this, as long as you are not being ungrateful to Allah Jalla wa'ala and not giving Allah the credit. Similarly, we find on the day of the conquest of Mecca, Bilal radiallahu anhu asked the Prophet alayhi salam, أَتَنْزِلُ فِي دَارِكَ غَدًا, will you lodge at your house tomorrow? And the Prophet replied, وَهَلْ تَرَكَ لَنَا أَقِيلٌ مِنْ دَارٍ أَوْ رَبَاعٍ, and has أَقِيلٌ left for us any house or living quarters? Aqil was a mushrik and he died as such, and the Muslims do not inherit from a mushrik. And so he said, Aqil has not left us anything. But this is just giving a news item. But as for if somebody pretends to forget that Allah Jalla wa'ala is the one who provides, then this is what is sinful. And this is what Mujahid intends when he made this statement. And then the author quotes the statement of Aun ibn Abdullah. He said that this ayah means somebody saying, if such and such a person would not have been, then such and such would not have occurred. So this is all about giving credit to somebody other than Allah, that some other person has the ability to have an effect on what happened or what will happen. And this type of statement is not haram in the absolute sense, but rather we can divide this kind of situation up into three types. Number one, if the cause is hidden and is not openly seen. For example, a person says about a dead saint, if it wasn't for such and such a dead saint, and he mentions him using his name, then such and such would not have happened. For example, if it wasn't for such and such a saint, I would not have recovered from my illness. Then a statement like this is shirk akbar. Why? Because he has introduced a cause for which there is no evidence in the Quran nor scientifically. And so he believes that this dead saint is able to manage the affairs of the creation. And this is shirk akbar, as we mentioned before, earlier on in this presentation. The second scenario, that a person makes a statement like this to a known cause for which there is evidence from the Qur'an or the Sharia or scientifically. And he says this just to inform what caused the event to happen, but he does not believe that this cause actually produced the event, but rather what produced the event was Allah Jalla wa'ala. And also he does not forget that Allah is the one who provides the rizq. For example, a person saying, if it wasn't for the clouds, we would not have rain. Yes, it's true, the clouds do bring rain, and you cannot have rain without the clouds. So this sabab, or this cause, is correct, scientifically correct, and in the Sharia also it is correct, because the Quran speaks about the cloud bringing rain. But this person must not believe that the clouds created the rain. Allah Jalla wa'ala rather created the rain, He creates everything, and He is the one who provides the rizq. However, because the clouds are a proper cause or sabab, you are allowed to say this. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked whether he can benefit Abu Talib in any way in the hereafter, and the Prophet replied, هُوَ فِي ضَحْضَحْ مِنَ النَّارِ, he is in the shallow end of the fire, عَلَيْهِ نَعْلَانَ مِنَ النَّارِ يَغْلِي مِنْهُمَا دِمَاغُهُ, He has two sandals of fire, which he's wearing, and his brain will boil because of them. And he said, وَلَوْلَا أَنَا لَكَانَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. And if it wasn't for me, he would be in the lowest depths of the fire. So here the Prophet ﷺ is linking the result to himself, because the Prophet is a genuine cause for Abu Talib to be in the shallow end of the fire, despite the fact that it is Allah who will put him in the shallow end of the fire. But because the Prophet is a legitimate cause, he is allowed to say it. And there is no shirk in this category, as long as you do not believe that this sabab or this cause is creating anything. The creator is Allah Jalla wa'ala alone. Then we have the third scenario. When you link the event to an apparent cause, which can be seen, but there is no proof from the Sharia nor from science that this is a legitimate cause. And so this is Shirk Asghar. And we spoke about this idea of cause before. For example, wearing these qala'id, these necklaces, and people believe that this necklace will be a cause to bring about some benefit or ward off some harm, or perhaps it will ward off the evil eye, then this necklace is a sabab for which there is no evidence from the Sharia nor scientifically that this is in fact a sabab. So as long as he does not believe that this necklace has the ability to create something, but rather he believes that the benefit and the harm will be brought by Allah Jalla wa'ala, then he has made a cause for which there is no evidence from the Sharia nor from science. Therefore, this becomes Shirk Asghar. As for if he believes that this necklace itself will bring about benefit or ward off harm, so in other words, he's believing that this necklace has the ability to have an effect on the affairs of the creation, then this is Shirk Akbar. So if he says in his statement that this necklace brought about good fortune, or if it wasn't for this necklace, I would not be healed from my illness, then this is Shirk Asghar, if he believes that this necklace is simply a cause, but it is Allah who brought about the benefit. Then the Shaykh mentions the tafsir of Ibn Qutaybah, who explained the ayah as saying, it is when they say, these blessings are a result of the intercession of their gods. And this type of statement is uglier than the ones that have preceded, because the mushrikun would worship their idols, and then they will say that all these ni'mah which they are enjoying are because of the intercession of these idols. They have interceded with Allah. So these mushrikeen have created a sabab for which there is no evidence. And their sabab is of course these idols. So they have made two mistakes. Firstly, they have worshipped these idols besides Allah. And secondly, they have made a sabab for which there is no evidence. Then the Shaykh quotes the statement of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, when speaking about the hadith of the Naw, which is the star which brings rain, as claimed by the people of Jahiliyyah, and the hadith has preceded. But Shaykh al-Islam said about this hadith, this happens much in the Qur'an and the Sunnah, that Allah rebukes those who give credit for the blessings of Allah to other than Allah. And this is similar to the case where, if a slave or a servant of somebody comes to you with a present, and if you now were to thank the servant and not the master of this servant, who sent you the present, then surely this would be deemed as bad manners and ingratitude, in that you did not thank the master of the slave who was actually responsible for giving you this present. And so if you relate this to the ni'mah of Allah, if you just give credit to the sabab and not the khaliq, then again this is bad manners, because Allah Jalla wa'ala is the one who created this sabab through which you are receiving these blessings. And also it is well known that the sabab itself does not have an effect, but rather the one who has the effect is the creator himself. This is as the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, لَيْسَتْ السَّنَةُ أَنْ لَا تُمْطَرُوا وَلَكِنَّ السَّنَةُ أَنْ تُمْطَرُوا وَتُمْطَرُوا وَلَا تُمْبِتُ الْأَرْضُ شَيْئًا. That a drought is not that you are not given rain, but rather the drought is that you are given rain and you are given more rain, but the earth does not produce any crops. So the point is that if crops are grown, you don't give credit to the rain, even though the rain was the sabab, but rather you give credit to Allah Jalla wa'ala, because He's the one who created the rain and He created the result of the rain. In other words, He created the sabab, the cause, and the musabab, the result of the cause. So we find from the hadith that the cause itself does not have an effect. So the rain does not actually produce the crops. As the Prophet says, that you could be given rain, but the earth might not produce anything. So the sabab does not create. Rather, it is Allah Jalla wa'ala who creates. Also, we know that there could be some preventative factor which prevents the sabab from producing the results. So it goes to show that the one who creates is not the sabab, it's the khaliq, which is Allah Jalla wa'ala. Some of the earlier scholars said, giving an example, that some people saying that the wind was blowing favorably. So the fact that the ship was sailing well they give the credit to the wind. Or for example, they might say the sailor was experienced and skillful. So they give the credit for the ship sailing well to the sailor. And they forget to give credit to Allah Jalla wa'ala and to praise Him for the ni'mah. Whether it be crops growing or whether it be the ship sailing well or any ni'mah. Allah Jalla wa'ala first and foremost must be thanked. Issues in this chapter. Issue number one, recognizing the blessings of Allah and then denying them. And we spoke about this. Issue number two, that these types of denials run on the tongues of most people. And this is as we have discussed. They say the wind was blowing well. This is why the ship sailed well. Or the sailor was extremely skillful. And you find this often happening with the kuffar. There is no concept whatsoever of thanking Allah Jalla wa'ala. Or at least saying Alhamdulillah for this ni'mah. They always give the credit to the sabab, never the khaliq. Issue number three, naming such statements as denial of the blessing. So these people who give the credit to the sabab, they don't deny that these blessings exist. Rather, we can see that these blessings exist before our very own eyes. But these statements which they use to give the sabab the credit as if the sabab was the creator, then these types of statements are denial. Issue number four, the combination of the two opposites in the heart. And this is taken from the ayah, يَعْرِفُونَ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ يُنْكِرُونَهَا. They know the ni'mah of Allah and then they deny it. The trait of iman is to recognize the ni'mah of Allah, and the trait of kufr is to deny this ni'mah. So to give credit to other than Allah. So these are two opposite traits. End of chapter, question number one. The ayah of the chapter from Surah An-Nahl, it talks about denying the favors of Allah. Explain how this negates Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Question number two. This idea of giving the sabab the credit, it falls into three categories. Explain these three categories. Let us now continue to the next chapter, number 42. It's about not setting up rivals with Allah. And the title of the chapter is the ayah from Surah Al-Baqarah, number 22. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً وَأَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجَ بِهِ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ رِزْقًا لَكُمْ فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. He says, O mankind, worship your Lord who created you and those before you in order that you may attain taqwa, the one who has made the earth a bed for you, or a resting place. And the sky, He has made a roof above you, and He has sent down from the sky water, and He has brought therewith fruits as provisions for you. So do not set up rivals to Allah whilst you know. Meaning to say, whilst you know that Allah Jalla wa'ala has given you all of this rizq, and you know He is your Lord, so why then are you setting up rivals with Him? And we know that the mushrikun, in the times of the Jahiliyyah, they acknowledged the fact that Allah Jalla wa'ala is the Rabb. So they had Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. But what they were lacking is the Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, because they set up rivals with Allah as they were worshipping their false gods. So the point is that the mushrikun have admitted that Allah has no partner in His Rububiyyah. So if that's the case, then let Him also have no partner in Uluhiyyah. And the mushrikun found it very difficult to worship just one God. As they said in Surah Sa'd, أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَاهٌ وَاحِدًا إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءٌ عُجَابٌ. Has He made all the gods into one God? This is something strange. And in their talbiyah, when they perform the hajj, the mushrikun would say, لَبَّيْكَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكْ إِلَّا شَرِيكًا هُوَ لَكْ تَمْلِكُهُ وَمَا مَلَكْ. We answer your call, you have no partner, except the partner who is with you, whom you own, and He does not own anything. And this is a foolish talbiyah, because if Allah has a partner whom Allah owns, then how can this partner actually be a partner if Allah owns him? So it's a self-contradiction. But this was from the foolishness of the shirk beliefs which they had. So the word andad, which is plural of nid, means a rival or a peer. And it is haram to set up rivals with Allah, whether it be in His tawheed al-rububiyyah, or tawheed al-uluhiyyah, or tawheed asma'i wa sifat. Then the Shaykh quotes what is reported from Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu in relation to the ayah which we quoted, that al-andad means shirk. It is more hidden than an ant crawling on a black stone in the darkness of the night. And it is that a person should say when he takes an oath, by Allah and by your life, and by my life. So up to now we learn that Ibn Abbas says that this andad is shirk. So he's giving the tafsir by what is intended. Otherwise we know that andad is a plural of nid and it means a rival or a pair. But Ibn Abbas is telling us the tafsir as a summation or a whole or what is intended by the ayah. So what is intended is shirk. This is because you can give a tafsir in two ways. Firstly, you can give a tafsir as a summation. So what is the sentence as a whole telling us? What's the information it's conveying? And you don't pay attention in this tafsir to the actual wordings itself, meaning the individual words. Then the second way is that you can give a tafsir with respect to the individual words and their meanings. So here you would have to look at the meanings of the individual words and not the sentence as a whole, which is opposite to the first type. So in this ayah, we can say that andad means rivals or pairs. So this is the tafsir with regards to the meaning of the word. Or we could say andad is setting up partners with Allah. So this is the tafsir with regards to what is intended from the ayah. And he's also telling us that this is a shirk which is so easy for us to perform that we would not even notice it, like an ant crawling on a black stone in the depths of the night. So it's almost impossible to notice. And this is why it has been narrated from one of the early Muslims that having al-ikhlas, sincerity to Allah, meaning doing your deeds purely for His sake, has been the greatest struggle for me. And in the example which he gives, when he says, by Allah and by your life. So he's taking an oath by Allah and by the life of the person to whom he is addressing. And in this, there are two types of shirk. Number one, swearing by other than Allah. So this is a minor shirk. And secondly, joining the life of the person you're speaking to and Allah Jalla wa'ala in one sentence when he says, by Allah and by your life. So they both come in one sentence and they are both on the same level. So he's making Allah and your life equal. As for swearing by other than Allah, then if the one who is taking this oath believes that the one he is taking an oath by is equal to Allah in status, then this is shirk akbar, takes you out of the fold of Islam. If he believes that what he is taking an oath by is of a lesser status than Allah, then this is shirk asghar. So taking an oath by other than Allah can be shirk akbar or it could be shirk asghar, depending on your belief. Then Ibn Abbas goes on, it is also the statement of someone, had there not been this little dog, then the thief would have come to us. Or had there not been this duck in the house, then the thief would have come. Or it is the statement of someone telling his companion, what Allah willed and you willed. Or the statement of a person, had it not been for Allah and such a person. So Ibn Abbas goes on to say, do not mention anyone with Allah because all of it is shirk. And this narration has been reported by Ibn Abi Hatim and is da'if, weak. So the problem with saying, had it not been for this dog, then the thief would have entered, is that this person is not giving credit to Allah Jalla wa'ala, but rather he's giving full credit to the dog, which is something you'd expect from a kafir. As for a Muslim, he would praise Allah Jalla wa'ala first and foremost. Of course, the dog is a valid sabab or a reason why the thief did not enter the house and was scared away. Therefore, there is no problem in you saying that because of the dog, the thief did not enter, because the dog is a valid sabab. But as long as you do not believe that the sabab itself has the ability to ward off harm or bring about benefit, but rather that happens from Allah Jalla wa'ala alone. And the evidence why you could say that had it not been for the dog, the thief would not have entered, is, as stated before, the statement of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam about Abu Talib, لَوْلَا أَنَا لَكَانَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. If it wasn't for me, he would have been in the lowest depths of the fire. Despite the fact that it is Allah who will take him out of the lowest depths of the fire and put him in the shallow end of the fire. But the Prophet is a valid sabab, a valid cause. So it's permissible to utter such words, but you need to take a look at the state of your heart. You must never be depending on the sabab. Rather, you must be depending on Allah Jalla wa'ala. One might ask, it's understandable that the dog could ward off the thief, but what about the duck? The duck can also ward off the thief because it will start to quack and make noise, and thieves do not like noise. And then you have the statement, what Allah willed and you willed, ma sha Allahu wa shi'ta. There's no doubt that humans do have a willpower. However, to join this human with Allah, this is inappropriate because you're making this human as a peer to Allah Jalla wa'ala, or a rival, or an equal. So if this person uttering this statement believes that this person is equal to Allah, then this is shirk akbar. And if he believes that this person is less than Allah Jalla wa'ala, then this is shirk asghar. And the same goes for لولا الله وفلان, if it wasn't for Allah and such a person. So somebody might say, if it wasn't for Allah and Ahmed helping me out, I would not have passed my exams. So this type of statement is shirk because he has put Ahmed and Allah on the same level. So again, it depends on his beliefs. If he believes that Ahmed is the same as Allah in terms of the rububiyyah, then this is shirk akbar. If he believes that Ahmed is less than Allah, then this is shirk asghar. The next evidence the Shaykh quotes, the hadith found in the Sunan on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, مَنْ حَلَفَ بِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَقَدَ كَفَرَ أَوْ أَشْرَكَ. Whoever swears or takes an oath by other than Allah, then he has committed kufr or shirk. This hadith is sahih لِغَيْرِهِ. So this hadith is telling us that taking an oath by other than Allah is kufr or shirk. What is well known is that you are allowed to take an oath by the names and attributes of Allah Jalla wa'ala, because his names and attributes are in following him. So for example, you can say وَعِزَّةِ اللَّهِ, by the honor of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ used to say, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ, by the one who has my soul in his hand. So if you take an oath by something which describes Allah Jalla wa'ala, then this is permissible. Or you can take an oath by his names, you can say وَالرَّحْمَن, by the Rahman, or وَالسَّمِيرُ, by the one who hears, or any other of his established names. In Arabic, there are three letters used to take an oath, the Ba, Da, and Waw. As for the Ba, this is the most flexible out of all of these three letters. You can use the Ba to say Billahi, and you can also say Uqasimu Billah, I swear by Allah, and you can also add the Dhamir. So you could say Allahu Azim Ahlifu Bihi La'af'alan, Allah is great, I swear by him that I will surely do whatever. So you're not saying Billah, you're saying Bihi, by him. So the Ha is a Dhamir referring to Allah. As for the Waw, then the situation is a little more strict. You cannot say Uqsimu Wallahi. It does not make sense in the Arabic language. You can only say Uqsimu Billahi. So you cannot mention the verb of the oath, Uqsim, which means I take an oath. And neither can you attach a Dhamir to it. So you could not say Ahlifu Wahu La'af'alan, I swear by him I will do such and such. But rather you could only say Ahlifu Bihi, I swear by him, with the letter Ba. As for the letter Ta, then this is yet stricter. You cannot mention the verb of the oath, so Uqsim. You cannot say Uqsimu Tallahi. Rather, you could only say Uqsimu Billahi, and neither can you attach the Dhamir. So you cannot say Ahlifu Tahu, I swear by him. This does not make sense. Only the Ba can be attached to the Dhamir. Further restrictions on the Ta is that you can only use the Lafzul Jalala, which is Allah, and Rabb, to take an oath with the letter Ta. So you can only ever say Tallahi or Tarrabbi. And you cannot use the other names and attributes of Allah to take an oath with the letter of Ta. You can, however, with the Ba and the Waw. So you can say Wassameer, Warrahman, Warrahim. Likewise with the Ba, Bissameer, Birrahman, Bil Ghafoor, and so on. So the Ba is the most flexible, the Waw is in the middle, and the Ta is the strictest. So the ruling on taking an oath by other than Allah is that if you believe that this thing is equal to Allah in terms of its rububiyyah or uluhiyyah or asma or sifat, then this is shirk akbar. But if you think that it is less than Allah, then it is shirk asghar, as explained before. The vital question is, will Allah Jalla wa'ala forgive you for this sin if you were to die without having repented from it? Because he says in Surah An-Nisa ayah 116, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ وَمَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. Verily Allah does not forgive that partners be made with him, but he forgives anything less than that to whomsoever he wills. And whoever makes shirk with Allah, then he has gone far astray. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says that this ayah includes both shirk asghar and shirk akbar. So upon that, taking an oath by other than Allah and dying not having repented from this, then this is an unforgivable sin and you necessarily have to be punished. And the justification he gives is that the ayah in Surah An-Nisa is general. So anything which can be called a shirk is a shirk. It makes no difference whether it is shirk akbar or shirk asghar. As long as it is shirk, it is shirk. And other scholars say that only the shirk akbar is intended in this ayah. Either way, it is an extremely serious matter. But somebody here might ask, Is it not true that Allah Jalla wa'ala in the Qur'an takes an oath by those things which are created and are clearly not the same as Allah? For example, he says, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا, by the sun and its early morning time. He says, لَا أُقْسِمُ بِهَذَا الْبَلَدِ, nay, I swear by this city. He says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَى, by the night as it covers. He says, وَالْقَلَمِ وَمَا يَسْطُرُونَ, by the pen and what they write. So clearly this is taking an oath by other than Allah. The first answer is, this is Allah Jalla wa'ala taking an oath. So how can anyone say that Allah is committing shirk? And then actions of Allah Jalla wa'ala cannot be questioned. He says, لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. He cannot be questioned about what he does, but they will be questioned. So Allah is the judge, and nobody can judge against him. The second point in this is that he swears by these objects to show how great and valuable these things actually are. So it's a type of praise which Allah is giving them. There is another argument that can be put forth. In the Sahih of a Muslim, when one of the Arab came to the Prophet ﷺ and asked him about what was obligatory upon him, and the Prophet informed him of the 5 prayers a day, and the zakah, and the psalm, and the man went away saying, I will not increase nor will I decrease from what I have been told, meaning from these obligatory duties. And in a narration in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said, أَفْلَحَ وَأَبِيهِ إِنْ صَدَقْ, by his father, if he has spoken the truth, he has succeeded. So they say that the Prophet ﷺ swore an oath by the father of that man. So did the Prophet commit shirk by doing so? There have been many explanations that have been given, but the best of the explanations, firstly, some ulama say that this narration is shadh, because it contradicts with the other narrations in Sahih al-Bukhari with other trustworthy narrators. And another explanation is that this used to happen before, but then it became abrogated. But of course, the condition for nasq is that it must not be possible to reconcile between the two evidences. Well, we find it's not possible to reconcile between these two evidences, as they are directly contradicting each other. But the other condition is that we need to know the date, and it does not appear that we know what the dates are for these narrations. So we cannot be sure that the narration prohibiting swearing by other than Allah came after this narration in the Sahih. So therefore this idea of nasakh is something we cannot actually be sure of. Somebody may argue back though and say, but could we not say that in the beginning it was haram to swear by other than Allah so that the iman could become firmly established in the hearts of the people, and then thereafter it became allowed? So actually they're taking the nasakh the other way around. Firstly it was haram and then it became halal. Again, we arrive at the same problem. We need to know the date. Which hadith came first and which came afterwards? Then and only then can we seriously talk about a nasakh or abrogation. So that's the first point. The second point is, it's better not to adopt this opinion, but rather it is better to say that at first these were the types of word which used to run on the tongues of the Arab. So they used to take oaths by their fathers, by my father or by your father. And then they were told to stop this sort of thing because it can lead to shirk akbar. And then thereafter it was finally made haram. Just like drinking intoxicants, it was allowed in the beginning, then gradually it was prevented until it became fully haram. The next evidence which the Shaykh quotes, the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, that he is reported to have said, to swear by Allah while lying is more beloved to me than to swear by other than him while speaking the truth. In the chain of transmission there is a missing link, rendering it da'if. But there is no problem in the meaning, because an oath by other than Allah is shirk, and taking an oath by Allah yet lying is a major sin. Just take a note here that Ibn Mas'ud said that taking an oath by Allah and lying is more beloved to me. In actual fact, nothing of the two is beloved to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, but he is just drawing a comparison here, because one is less sinful than the other. So taking an oath by Allah and lying, first of all, there is a sin of lying in and of itself is haram. Then secondly, you're taking an oath by Allah. And whatever you take an oath by, it is a type of ta'zeem, or a veneration of that thing. This is the whole idea of an oath, is that you're venerating that which you are taking an oath by. And this type of veneration or ta'zeem only belongs to Allah Jalla wa'ala. This is why it is shirk to take an oath by other than Allah. And some ulama have said that taking an oath by Allah and lying is the al-yameen al-ghamus. Ghamus means to dip something in something else. Like if you were to take your finger and dip it in the water. This is because this kind of yameen or an oath, it dips you completely in sin. And it dips you in the fire completely. Just like you might dip a biscuit in your cup of tea. So to compare between the two types of oaths, one is a major sin and the other one is shirk. And even shirk asghar is more dangerous than a major sin. As we have stated before from Surah An-Nisa, ayah 116, that Allah does not forgive that shirk be made with him. But he forgives anything less than that, to whomsoever he wills. And anyone who performs shirk has gone far astray. And there is no doubt amongst the ulama that shirk is the greatest sin that you can possibly commit. And it is also the greatest form of oppression that you can do to yourself. As Luqman told his son, يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ O my son, do not make shirk with Allah. Verily shirk is a great ظلم or transgression or oppression. And in the authentic hadith, the Prophet was asked, أَيُّ ذَنْبِ أَعْظَمْ Which sin is greatest? And he replied, أَنْ تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقَكْ That you should make a rival with Allah whilst He has created you. The next evidence, the hadith, on the authority of Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet said, لَا تَقُولُوا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَشَاءَ فُلَانَ وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ شَاءَ فُلَانَ Do not say what Allah willed and what such and such a person willed, but rather say what Allah willed and then what such and such a person willed. This hadith is in Sunan Abi Dawud and is authentic, sahih. So in this narration, the difference between the halal and the haram is simply that the waw has been changed to thumma, because the waw means and. So you're putting this person and Allah on the same level. And we said that the minimum that can be said about this is that it is shirk asghar. And it can also be shirk akbar depending on your belief, as mentioned before. As for if you were to say, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ شَاءَ فُلَانَ Then the word thumma means and then. So there is clearly an order. Allah comes first and then such and such a person comes. Is it permissible to say, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ فَشَاءَ فُلَانَ What Allah willed, then what such and such a person willed. The letter fa also indicates an order. So Allah comes first and then such and such a person. But it is not quite as emphatic as thumma. So what is apparent is that this is permissible, because there is this order which separates Allah from the other person. We can take from the hadith that the slave does have a willpower. So this hadith therefore is a rebuttal against the Jabariyya, who say that the slave does not have a willpower and he's forced, literally forced, to do everything which he does, be it evil or be it good. We also take from this hadith a valuable lesson. If you're going to make something haram, give people an alternative which is halal, just as we find in this hadith. So what is haram is to say wa, and what is halal is to say thumma when you're taking the oath and joining between Allah and someone else. Similarly, in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 104, we find, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقُولُوا رَاعِنَا وَقُولُوا انظُرْنَا O you who believe, do not say رَاعِنَا, which means be considerate to us, but rather say انظُرْنَا, make us understand. وَلِلْكَافِرِينَ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ And for the kuffar, there is a painful torment. This is because the Yahud used to say رَاعِنَا to the Prophet, but in the Hebrew language, رَاعِنَا means an insult. So they would say this to the Prophet to mock him. Likewise, in the hadith, when Bilal radiallahu anhu came along with some good quality dates and the Prophet asked him, are all the dates of Khaybar good quality like this? And he said, no, we sell 2 sa' of poor quality dates and we buy 1 sa' of good quality dates. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, لا تفعل ولكن بع الجمع بالدراهم ثم اشتري بالدراهم جنيبا He said, don't do this, but rather sell the mixed dates, meaning the poor quality dates, for darahim. Then with these darahim, purchase the good quality dates. So after explaining to him what is haram, he explained to him a halal alternative. Because just explaining what is haram is going to make life difficult for people. And it will actually make them averse to this deen. So the sharia closes doors and opens others. And this hadith of the chapter is another such an example. Then the next evidence which the Shaykh quotes, what has been narrated from Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, that he did not like the statement, أعوذ بالله وبك, I seek refuge in Allah and in you. But it is permissible to say, أعوذ بالله ثم بك, I seek refuge in Allah first and then you. And he said that you should say, if it wasn't for Allah and then you. and that you should not say, if it wasn't for Allah and you. This narration is weak. As for the statement, A'udhu billahi wa bik, I seek refuge in Allah and in you, then this is haram and it is shirk, as mentioned before, because you're combining between Allah and the person you're addressing. And so this word wow is used to denote equality. But of course there is nothing equal to Allah. But it is permissible to say, I seek refuge in Allah and then in you. Somebody might ask, have we not previously discussed that it is not permissible to seek refuge, which is al-isti'adha, in anyone other than Allah? And this has been one of the previous chapters. We say it is permissible to seek refuge with someone who is able to provide you refuge, because Allah Jalla wa Ala has made this person a valid means of your refuge. But if somebody was to say, A'udhu billahi thumma fulan, I seek refuge in Allah and then with such and such a person, and this person is dead, then no doubt that this is shirk akbar, not asghar. Because clearly a person who makes this statement believes that this dead person has the ability to affect the affairs of the creation. So he's giving him a share of rububiyyah, whereas Allah Jalla wa Ala has not made this dead person a valid sabab. So if you believe that something which is not a valid sabab has the ability to change the affairs of the creation and to have an effect in day-to-day life, then this is the essence of shirk akbar. Somebody might say, we have the authentic hadith that when a person lodges up in a place and then he says, أَعُوذُ بِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ التَّامَّاتِ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقَ, I seek refuge in the perfect words of Allah from the evil of what He has created. Then if he makes this dua, nothing will harm him until he leaves this place. And Al-Imam Ahmad said that this dua proves that the words of Allah are not created, because you're not allowed to seek refuge in that which is created. And just a little while ago we said that it is permissible to seek refuge in a creation if it is a valid sabab. So how do we combine between these two viewpoints? Because according to Al-Imam Ahmad, you are not allowed to seek refuge in another person. So what we say is that the statement of Al-Imam Ahmad is to be understood as him saying that al-isti'adha cannot be sought with a created speech, but rather it can only be sought with a speech which is not created. And the speech of Allah Jalla wa Ala is not created because it is from His attributes. And the attributes of Allah are not created because they are in following Allah. So basically we can say that it is not permissible to seek refuge in the speech of somebody else, because this speech is created. Issues in this chapter. Issue number one, the tafsir of the ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah. And we spoke about this. Issue number two, the companions used to explain that the ayat revealed about shirk also include ash-shirk al-asghar. And this is because when he said, فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ, this is talking about the mushrikun. And of course the mushrikun were committing shirk akbar. But Abdullah ibn Abbas explained it as being shirk asghar when he gave the examples of statements.
So what do shirk akbar and shirk asghar have in common? Well, at least two things. Number one, that in both of them your heart is attached to other than Allah Jalla wa Ala. And secondly, in both of them you believe that benefit is being brought forth by other than Allah, or harm is being warded off by other than Allah Jalla wa Ala. So the point being that shirk is shirk, whether it is asghar or akbar. And that is how Ibn Abbas understood the case to be.
Issue number three, to take an oath by other than Allah is shirk. And this is clear from the hadith, مَنْ حَلَفَ بِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ كَفَرَ أَوْ أَشْرَكَ. Issue number four, to take an oath by other than Allah, being truthful, is worse than al-yameen al-ghamus, when you swear by Allah telling a lie. Al-yameen al-ghamus, some ulama say, it is when you swear by Allah and you are lying. Other ulama say, it is when you swear by Allah and you are lying in order to take some of the wealth of another Muslim. So they stipulate this condition. And this appears to be the correct opinion. Issue number five, the difference between the wow and thumma. When it comes to the wow, it indicates equality, and thumma indicates an order. So using the wow, it is shirk, and using the thumma, when you combine between Allah and someone else, this is permissible. And we can also say that the fa is also permissible. So it's like saying, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ فَشَاءَ فُلَانَ. So this also indicates an order. End of chapter, question number one. Explain the reasoning why taking an oath by other than Allah, or His names, or His attributes, is shirk. Question number two. If somebody tells you, but didn't the Prophet ﷺ take an oath by the father of the man who came from outside, asking him about the obligatory duties, and the Prophet said, أَفْلَحَ وَأَبِيهِ إِنْ صَدَقْ, by his father, if he told the truth, he will be successful. So how do you reconcile between this and the idea that swearing by other than Allah is shirk? Question number 3, what is the difference between the waw and the thumma? And quote the hadith from the chapter which could be used as evidence to show that the sharia makes certain things haram but gives a halal alternative. Chapter 43, what is said about the one who is not satisfied with an oath taken by Allah. The first question is, what has this chapter got to do with Kitab al-Tawheed? First of all, we know that when you take an oath by Allah, then this is a form of ta'zeem. You are venerating Allah Jalla wa Ala. So the person to whom you are swearing, and of course this oath is by Allah, then he too must venerate the name of Allah Jalla wa Ala, because the name of Allah has been taken in this oath. So both the one who is taking the oath and for whom it is taken, they both have to venerate the name of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Therefore, if somebody takes an oath by Allah and still you are not satisfied, then this is a deficiency in your ta'zeem of Allah, or in your veneration of Allah. And so this would negate the perfection of your tawheed. This idea of being pleased and content with somebody swearing by Allah can be divided into two types. Firstly, if it is a ruling in a sharia court and a person has to take an oath to prove his case, then you have to be pleased with this oath if he takes this oath by the name of Allah. And secondly, if this is a matter outside the sharia court case, and it may be an everyday matter, and somebody takes an oath, then if this person is known to be a liar or deceptive, then you are allowed to be discontent with his oath, and it is not wajib for you to be content. Because in the case of Huwayyisa and Muhayyisa, who were two companions, and they came to the Prophet complaining that they suspected the Yahud of killing Abdullah ibn Sahal. And the Prophet asked them if the Yahud took 50 oaths and they would clear their names. They said, how can we be pleased with the oaths of the Yahud? Because the Yahud were known for being deceptive and lying. And the Prophet ﷺ acknowledged this statement of theirs. So let's take a look at the first evidence, the hadith on the authority of Ibn Umar radiallahu an, that the Prophet ﷺ is reported to have said, لا تحلفوا بآبائكم من حلف بالله فليصدق ومن حلف له بالله فليرضى ومن لم يرضى فليس من الله. Do not swear by your forefathers. Whoever takes an oath by Allah, let him speak the truth. And the one for whom the oath is taken in the name of Allah must be satisfied with it. And whoever is not satisfied with it, then he is not from the slaves of Allah. This hadith is reported in the Sunan of Ibn Majah and is da'if. So we are told in this hadith to be truthful when you swear by Allah. So when you swear by Allah, does this mean you have to be 100% sure that what you're saying is the truth? Or does it suffice for you to be almost sure that what you're saying is the truth? Meaning you're perhaps 70, 80, 90% sure, but not 100. The answer is that it suffices you to be almost sure. So whatever is predominant in your thoughts, you're allowed to take an oath by Allah. And the evidence for this found in the Sahih, when a poor person committed intercourse with his wife during the daytime of Ramadan, and he was asked to feed poor people with some dates, and he said, Wallahi ma bayna labitayha ahlu baytin afqaru minni. Wallahi, there is no family between the two mountains of Al-Madinah who is poorer than me. The question is, did this person do a survey to check who is poorer than him or not? No, he was just speaking from his dhan, what he thought to be probable. And the Prophet ﷺ acknowledged this statement of his. Basically, it means it is permissible to take such an oath. And whoever is not happy with an oath by Allah, then he is not from the true obedient slaves of Allah. Of course, it must be noted that if the person taking an oath by Allah is known to be a liar, or you know he is speaking false, then you do not have to be content with this oath. So for example, if he says, by Allah, this bag is made out of wood, and you can clearly see that it's made out of leather, then just because he has sworn by Allah Jalla wa Ala, does it mean you have to believe him and be content with his oath? No, it does not. So the rule is, if this person is known to be a liar, or he is a person of deception, then you do not have to be content with the oath. As for when it comes to a sharia ruling, like a court decision in a sharia court, then whoever takes an oath, you have to be content with it. because taking an oath is one of the ways in which the judge decides the case.